We've had some heavy testimonies, and this is a heavy testimony. It is about how God restored me after satanic ritual abuse. And I think this topic, God released me to do this this time. And I believe the reason is because it's surfaced before, it surfaced in the 90s, and it's surfacing again in various fragmented forms. And it's particularly, well, it's kind of amazing that that we're doing it in Seaside. As we're speaking, the woman that I was paired up today when Dr. Phillips asked us to sit by somebody we didn't know, was a woman who, surprise, surprise, is counseling satanic ritual abuse survivors. And so I know that, especially in this area, in all areas, but especially in this area, I think it's very prevalent. So the themes here have been prayer, pray, listen, hear, gratitude. And that is really what God has taught me through healing in all of this. And he has taught me the intimacy of him. And he has taught me that it is him and he alone. And so I have notes here, and I know time is of the essence. And so I'm going to use my notes. There was a neighbor who brought me the Lord Jesus Christ. She was the one who came in and said, Katie, you need Jesus. And I didn't know my place of pain would be my place of gain. And we knelt by my old rugged sofa in my living room. And I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. From my point of view, really, I was the original desperate housewife. I was 34 years old. I had been married a second time, and for the second time, my marriage was in shambles, and we've had so much good teaching about relationships and marriage, and we've had great, and it's needed. It's needed. But I had something this time that I hadn't had the first marriage, and that was I had a newborn. I had a tiny life that was entrusted to me. And what did I know then? I knew that I wanted to be a mother. I knew that I wanted this child, but I was pregnant when Brian and I got married. So I knew that my relationship was in shambles. My life felt like it was in shambles. There was an agony there that, yeah, granted my situation wasn't great, but there was a deeper pain there. When I accepted the Lord, it felt immediate impact. I felt the peace of Jerusalem just invade my essence. Some people don't have that. I did. I felt also like he imparted in me a large, large measure of faith. Shortly after I accepted the Lord, Hebrews 11:6 became my life verse. And even before I knew the Lord all that well, I thought, okay, faith. I'm gonna need faith, and I did. I needed every drop of faith to get through this journey. He had work to do. Little did I know that he was gonna have to cut through layers and layers and layers of abuse. And boy, did I need work. But he wanted me to know two things. He wanted me to know, number one, that he existed, and number two, that what happened to me really happened to me. Now, this is hard for most people to understand. This is really where rubber hits the road with satanic ritual abuse, because people don't really believe that that's happening. And number two, if you are a survivor, you don't believe it happened to you. And that is the hardest part of this journey. It's hard to believe something that you don't really can't remember, but or have no conscious recollection of. But gradually, as the dams of memory, flashbacks, body memories, dreams, and finally visions unfolded, I embraced that my body really had its own story to tell me, as did my mind and my emotions. I learned to play detective. I was the mystery. The more I believed, the more that was uncovered, the more my body revealed to me, and the more I was healed. So, what is satanic ritual abuse? My family was involved with a cult, identified as satanic, and in these cults, programming is accomplished by various measures. Many people these days have experienced sexual abuse, and that cuts and rips through your body, literally shredding you. Shreds your emotions, it shreds your body, it shreds your mind. And there's an added layer here in cult abuse, and that's programming. Programming is accomplished by various means, gang rape, lots of sex. Sexual orgies, men, women, children, it's all over the board. They use mind-altering drugs primarily to administer to you, to stage you in events that you literally believe are happening to you, to terrorize you, to keep you within the cult, to keep you quiet about the cult, and to keep you quiet about the activities of the cult. When you have intense mental drama, the facts and feelings of a crisis are distributed in various parts of your body and mind so that you can stay functioning. And we often see this in post-traumatic stress. Now it's surfacing from wars. But healing most frequently comes through flashbacks, dreams, ways that human beings can begin to experience and integrate it into their everyday lives so that they don't self-destruct, hopefully. There's another layer that's added, and that is, as I said, programming. But the other way they do that is that they will program you to be triggered by everyday events, colors, smells, sounds, holidays, seasons, and so you are in almost a perpetual state of mental and emotional, and yes, eventually physical fog. And I lived half my life that way. And so the agony that I was beginning to feel during just after the birth of my first and only child, natural child, was the beginning of the walls of secrets just beginning to burst. When I accepted the Lord in my life, God began to tear these walls down. And what that means is detoxing, really rebuilding my body, my emotions, and my mind. The biggest thing, the biggest challenge I had, as I mentioned, was the thought that I was not going to go crazy, or that I was not crazy, or that I was not mentally ill. Because after every flashback, it was like, I'm crazy, I'm mentally ill, this couldn't have happened, this, you know, and most people that you talk to, of course, there's nobody to talk to about these things. So God had to really supernaturally begin to bring people into my life, and that is what he did. So I could go into miracle after miracle after miracle of how he brought people into my life, but I'm not going to do that for the sake of time. One of the things also is that I had teams of people who were in deliverance. I had two pastors who listened to me. I had a therapist that I could go into the miracle of how I got attached to him, but he was a lifeline. I was with him for 6 years, saw him sometimes twice a week, and we're friends today. We're both writers and friends. I had two pastors concurrently with this who listened and listened. And I can tell you, this is not easy listening. This is not easy listening. This testimony is pretty sanitized. Because I love you guys. And because you don't have to do, you didn't have to do the work that they did. But they would pale when, they would sit there and pale. Their faces would be contorted. They would do white knuckle. But they were there for me, and they did two things. They listened, and they listened, and they listened, and they listened, and they believed me. And they told me I was not crazy. Mm-hmm. You are not crazy.
Yes.
And that is the main thing I needed to go from step to step to step. I'm going to give you one visual that I had. I was driving down the Banfield one day, beautiful day. I was going about my daily activities, and all of a sudden I had a visual. Now I was I was about mid healing range here, but I had a rain of male organs coming down at my windshield, just like a rain of penises. And I got off the freeway. Well, miracle number one is that I did not have an accident. Miracle number two is that I went to the emergency room and I said, I'm having an emotional breakdown. I need to be institutionalized. Miracle number three was that I had a nurse who said to me, you are not crazy. Now, she should have probably put me in an institution, given me drugs, but she didn't. She said to me, she looked at me in the eye and she said, you're not crazy. And she said, I think you're having your body memory.
Wow.
So God did that kind of thing all the way along. God in all of us spiritually, but God. One of the first things he did is he taught me how to listen to him. And listening has been the theme today. Listen. Next to the Bible, I still go to it now. One of my valuable books is Waiting on God by Andrew Murray. I still have that discipline instilled in me. I needed that discipline or I would be dead. He drove me to listening to him by getting me to pray. The more I prayed on my knees, the more I listened. And my first faith challenge was Brian and I were separated at one time. And he had been financially supporting us, but he lost his job, so nobody had any money. So what I did is I had a little notebook. And at the beginning, I was buoyed by childlike faith. At the beginning of every day, and I was a single mom now, I put down how much I needed to get through the day. $23.60, I'd say. Lauren, I made $23.60. At the end of the day, in my mailbox, was $23.60. And I lived that way for 3 months. Well, he got my attention. He got my attention. And I learned to listen. The other thing was that the pastors who listened, I had deliverance teams that came in, prayer warriors. The two pastors that really did the deepest work with me, their theologies did match up with the demonic, with deliverance, with laying on of hands. They didn't. They did not match up. And again, God used whom he used.
Amen.
To do what he wanted to do. And so let that be a lesson today, that just because a certain denomination or a certain somebody should know something, no, God is going to use whom he's going to use. Throughout this time, I managed to keep my marriage intact. My husband was a drinker, too, by attending Al-Anon to attend to my own stuff, though I was really getting tired of all my own stuff. I was getting very tired of my own stuff, and I'm reminded today through some things that I've heard that people don't believe in wickedness, and that's dishonoring to God. I'm here to say wickedness is real.
Amen.
But I am a functioning human being. Now, I'm not perfect, and I do get ditzy at times, and I still have challenges, but I am, for the most part, a functioning human being. And so, hallelujah. He is more than a conqueror. He will do it. What the enemy had intended,
I'm here.
So we, our family has remained in that. Miraculously. You know, this is not a piece of cake to be married to. This is not something that you just go, oh, wow. Okay, Lord. My husband had his issues, so did I. We both had bad pickers. We bonded by our deep wounds. And somehow God, step by step, kept us alive and well. I'm just going to close now because I know time is an issue. I celebrated my 69th birthday last month. It was a great time. It was a friend of mine that said, I'm going to throw you a party. And I said, well, you know, I don't do parties very well. And I said, and usually people celebrate on their 70th. They celebrate on their 70th birthday. And I'm only going to be 69. Well, we went on with it, and it was an amazing party. Everybody that was at the party, because of the weather, was going to be inside, outside, a lot of prayer. We prayed over this party. And the people there it was an amazing party. It was unity, love, not everybody knew each other. Fragments of my life are there. People flowed. It was wonderful. Well, one of the things I understood from that party, and particularly today, is that it took me 35 years to complete the healing process, which was completed at 69. And I have been released. Well, the other thing that really touches my heart is just the day I was gonna sit down and start this testimony, my son, who is 35, came to me, and he has come to the end of himself. He sobbed and sobbed and sobbed and sobbed and sobbed over his own personal grief and over the grief of losing his brother. We lost a son 2 years ago to suicide. And that is beginning to open up. And I say, you know, is this a curious coincidence? No. I think not. And my question to you is, are you willing to find your life? There has been a lot of talk today about losing your life to God. I think it takes a lot of courage when you're in the middle of abuse, when you're in the middle of not knowing what is going on, to choose life. And you have to choose life to live your life so that you can give your life. And that is by faith. And so that is what I'm saying to you. Regardless of whether you have this kind of level of trauma in your life, you still have things where you have to, on a daily basis, say, I choose life. I choose life. So, that is my testimony, and thank you.
Go ahead, Bruce. Go ahead, no. supposed to do this, but I pray about it. And I just want everybody here to know that if you don't know me, my name is Darcy Barth, and I have been involved with Women of Purpose almost from its conception. And but it took about 10 years. And I still kept in contact, and I'd show up every now and then, but I wasn't really involved. And I was really involved at the beginning. And I put a lot of time and a lot of, I did a lot of things. Virginia said she didn't know what to do with me because I'd be over here doing decorations and then I'd be going taking somebody, you know, food or picking somebody up and moving them somewhere or something. But Biggie and I are really close and have been for a long time. And so I would always keep tabs on Women of Purpose through her. And so whenever they would see me, you guys would see me, say, oh yeah, this is Darcy Barnes, she's at large. So I was at really at large. And so I just wanted to say thank you for the relationships that I have made here and that I'm going to make here. And for the family and the support that I feel. You know how you haven't seen somebody for a long, long time, and then when you come and see them, it's just like your heart just pounds. That's how I feel today. I did pray, and just a few, when we were having lunch, the Lord said that I wasn't, the Lord said that I was supposed to say something, and it doesn't really match with anything else that he gave me, and it's really crazy. So, I'm gonna do it. I'm not crazy. So. Duck and cover!
Oh my goodness. Duck
and cover.
She said duck and cover.
Yeah. What does that mean to you? I'm asking you, what did you do when I said that? What did it say inside of you? Okay, why? Why would God say that? Why would he say duck and cover?
Something's coming.
Maybe so. Maybe not. We don't know. Okay. So, I'm just going to tell you what he did say to me. He said, listen with your heart open. Open your heart and listen. Be ready in season and out of season. Don't take offense. And if you do, take care of it quickly. Let's see the other thing he was talking to me about. Darkness. He showed me about darkness. I showed a little bit at prayer the other day. We think of darkness, and the darkness of the enemy is evil. And not knowing of the divine. That's what it says. That if it's evil darkness, it's not knowing. And but sometimes to get real close to God Almighty and to carry his presence, we have to go into the thick darkness that surrounds God. There was a veil, a thick veil that went around the Holy of Holies. Jesus rent that for us. But if it was still there around the Holy of Holies, we would have to press our way through it. And it would be heavy, and it would be thick, and there would be darkness. I read about Moses. He had all of the Lord showed up on the mountain, and there was smoke, and there was fire, and there was thick darkness. And each of the tribes sent a member up to him and said, sorry, Moses, I'm not going in there, and none of us want anything to do with a God like that. We know that he's real, and we heard him speak from the mountain,
But you go and you find out what he wants us to do.
But Moses, he went into the thick darkness to meet his God face to face. Are you afraid of the darkness? If you need to study what the word says about who you are, if you are afraid of darkness, because we are the light, and the light of Jesus is in us. And so we should have no fear of darkness, not darkness of evil or darkness of the physical, darkness of any kind, because if we go into darkness, we bring light. And that changes the darkness. With the true reality of who you are in Christ, you will be able to love not your life unto the death. And that's what the Lord's been saying to me lately, is that it doesn't matter what you have to go through or the tasks that he give you that might seem impossible or never ending. But if you love not your life unto the death, none of that matters. Because God will give you strength day by day, minute by minute, whatever the case may be. And he will help you to make it through those things. Now, the opposite problem, which is mainly mine, where you say yes to too many things without really seeking whether God said this is what you're supposed to do or not.
Yeah.
We kind of talked about that, you know, being busy this morning in the lesson. So we have to be careful and find a balance for that. And I'm working on that right now. But I want to share just one more thing about the conference. You all know that I worked on the banner.
Yeah. Beautiful
and that
job.
Was a miracle of God. And I just want to speak that. I don't have to tell you that, but that's just what the Lord said. That banner is alive.
Amen.
The other thing is with the river of life, and I had that fabric for 10 years and knew that it was for river of life. And every time I took it out and said, oh, I love this color, I could do this, I could do that. He said, no, that's river of life banner, put it back. So I've known that that fabric was that banner for that many years and never was able to do it. The other thing is, see that tree over there? I was praying about our theme, Standing Strong, United in Love. And I was just totally blank, and that's not like me. Usually I have some little inkling of something I can do. And just blank, totally blank. And coming home from working with Jim one day, I said, Lord, what would be a symbol of standing strong, united in love? And all of a sudden, just dropped out of God's heavenly place was trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. And then I thought, oh, wow, that's so cool. You know, where is that scripture? I had no idea that it was for the ones that mourn. I didn't know that it was the oil of joy for mourning, and that it was for the spirit of heaviness, the garment of praise. I didn't realize that was all hooked together. I've always heard it separated, but it's not supposed to be separated. Those who mourn in Zion, and if that doesn't describe the church today, what does? We're mourning over the losses, and over the defeats, and over the separation. And God's just gonna restore it. He's gonna restore it. He's gonna give us oil for joy. He's gonna give us beauty for ashes. He's gonna give us a garment of praise for a heavy spirit. And he's gonna say, you are called trees of righteousness. The planting of the Lord, for what reason? Does anybody know what reason? To give glory to God.
Amen.
Yes, you have to give glory to God. So I just wanted to share that, and I did that so that we could have a place to just go and sit under the tree, like in Song of Solomon, where she said, I sat under the apple tree, and I ate of his fruit, and I was refreshed. And so that's what I wanted to let you guys all know. Also, I have one more thing. This isn't with my testimony, but I need about 16 volunteers to do a presentation for River of Light on Sunday, and we're going to be a live tree. Maybe two if I get enough volunteers. And we're going to do...
Tracy has started the minutes for you.
Good. Anyway, if there's anybody else that has it on your heart to help with being a tree of righteousness, then you let us know. Talk to Tracy. Thank you.
Jesus is the Christ, my Savior, my King, my God, the Savior of the world, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. I know that for sure. I know he saved me almost 50 years ago. He took me out of a horrible pit. And he placed me on a rock. And that rock is Christ Jesus. Without him, I can do nothing. I am nothing. And I don't want to be without him. There's a scripture that says, work out your own soul salvation with fear and trembling. And that has been the way I live my life, because man puts us in a box. They put religion in front of us instead of truth and the realness of a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. There's so many people that are sitting in churches that call on the name of Christ and they don't have a relationship. And without a relationship, you're lost. I was lost in church. I was lost in church. I was in pain in church. Going to church every Sunday, not really knowing that, understanding that Jesus really loved me, he really cared for me, he is my answer, that he's everything. Through my life, my married life, which is somewhere about 45, 46 years, lots of pain, lots of hurt, causing it, having it, And through just reading some self-help books, understanding that some of it came from my history and working on it, going to counselors and, you know, they tell you this, and Christian counselors. But here's what I learned. First of all, I build a relationship with Jesus. And then, so therefore, I can hear him. And regardless of what the pastor said, the minister said, the counselor said, I'm working out my salvation. Holy Spirit, what are you telling me to do? Because sometimes what God is telling us to do doesn't look like what other people are doing, doesn't sound like what other people are saying. Like she said, whatever what she said a while ago, I mean, that's not the norm. So therefore, you know, you're trying to stay in this little box that people are putting you in, but God is saying, no, this is what I want you to do. So going through this counseling and stuff, I have people telling me, no, I don't, using it prophetically, saying, no, I don't see you with him. I don't see, because the reality and the statistics say he's going to continue. But I know in whom I believe.
Amen.
And I know what God told me.
Amen.
And so I went back home. I left for a while because God said leave. And what I heard was, I was sitting in church. Pop Winans from the Winans was at our church, and he's saying to me, it's me, oh Lord, who's standing in the need of prayer. Because, you know, Miss Self-Righteous, I'm saying, he needs prayer. Change him, fix him, you know. And there was nothing he could say to me, because he's not reading the word. He quit going to church. So you ain't got nothing to say to me. So then after I leave, I get out on my knees and next to that bed, and God sings it to me. I'm like, Lord, do this, Lord, do that. And he said, I got you here because you're not hearing me over there. You can't hear me because you're busy fighting a war. You're being self-righteous. You're blah, blah, got your neck thrown in and whatever else. And so for that year, God dealt with me, and I learned some things on, first of all, I wasn't telling the truth about what I wanted, anything to keep the peace. So I'm driving down the street one day, or we're driving down the street one day, and he says to me, I don't know why that doctor wants me to quit drinking. And I'm saying, and so to keep the peace, I'm fixing to say nothing. And the Holy Spirit say, so then you're a liar. Because you're not saying what you want. You know what I'm saying? You're in this situation, and we're trying to keep the peace and keep everything nice and be this perfect wife, but we're not telling the truth. Sandra Sock told the truth.
Yeah.
She tells the truth. We need to tell the truth. Because how will they know what we really want? And if they really love us and care about us, like Clarence is saying, and my husband loves me, and I know he does. And so therefore, when I speak up and say what I really want, he changes. Sometimes it takes a while. You know, brother, a little slow sometimes. But he changes. And if I'm walking in love, and if the other thing that God told me was, because I'm reading this scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, he said, he's your neighbor. So quit looking at him like he's your property and you get to treat him and talk to him like you want to. He is your neighbor. He is your brother. And so treat him so, because he belongs to me. Because we have this attitude like, it's like they're our property and we get to say what we want to and do what we want to and treat them any kind of way. And it's like, no. So then I have to humble myself and respect. And there's a scripture that talks about God, what men want is respect. We're to love them and respect them and honor. They love us and we're to respect them. So I had to switch my whole little stuff around. I had to switch it all around. And it's still a work in process, because Deborah Sue rises up every now and again. You know? And it's like, no, I want you, Jesus. I want what you want. And the only way that I'm going to get what you want and what I want, because what I want is what you want, is to walk humbly before him, walk in love without an attitude, as Michael was saying, unselfishly.
Yes. I want to start with the word of God, mm-hmm. because it's because of his word and his sacrifice and victory we can gather in his name. All nations, all kinds, all times, all nations, and come in oneness of mind and heart, and of very soul, and believe for one another. And in Ephesians 3, starting, I'm just going to read a couple of verses, starting verse 12, because of Christ and our faith in him, we can now boldly come and confidently into God's presence. So please don't lose heart. Because of my trials here, I'm suffering for you, so you should feel honored. But when I think of all this, I fall to my knees, and I pray to the Father, the creator of everything in heaven and earth, and on earth, and I pray from his glorious unlimited resources, he will empower you with inner strength through his spirit, and Christ will make his home in your hearts. As you trust in him, and your roots will go on down deep into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, how deep his love is. Lord God, we gather in your love. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this conference, Lord God. But Lord Jesus, we thank you for every day of our life. That Lord, you have gathered us here for such a time as this. And Lord God, I ask that we are expecting for the miraculous from the inside out. Not to have anything to do with us, but Lord, because you are who you are. You are God, and in you, nothing is impossible. As our founder reminded us this morning, it is because of your love we come to the river of life. And Lord, drench us, rain on us, submerge us from the top of our head to the bottom of our feet. And Lord God, we just ask that you bless the speakers. And Lord God, we would take what they say that you have given them for such a time as this, and seated deep into our hearts. And Lord God, may the fruit of your spirit be rich and blessed in Jesus' name. And Lord, we give you all the praise and all God's people send.